Like I said this morning, I'm going to focus on to enter the secret place of the Lord. The most important thing for us as the church and the body of Christ in this time is to enter the secret place of the Lord. And I want to give a teaching on that this morning, and I hope to help people in this and how to approach God and how to enter into the secret place. Because many people don't know or don't realize that there is a secret place called the secret place. Some other names as well. What we're seeing happening in the world today and this whole situation all over the world today, as children of God, we should look at it from a different perspective. We should look at it from a heavenly perspective. Yes, the devil's trying to push down his agenda upon us. He's trying to enslave the nations. He's trying to prepare the way for the Antichrist. He's busy doing that. But we as church, the body of Christ, is the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. As long as we are here, he will not succeed. Come on. As long as we are here, he will not succeed. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. As a matter of fact, it is not the church that is on the back foot. It is the kingdom of darkness that is on the back foot. The devil is trying everything in his power to save his kingdom, because the kingdom of God is advancing. Even in this time, thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people are coming to the Lord every day. Even in countries like and nations like Iran. Iran, can you believe it? Is now experiencing a great revival. People are coming to the Lord in this time. So the church is not defeated. And we need to speak victory. Can you say amen here this morning? 2003, like all leaders, we come to a place sometimes, a hard place, a difficult place. Maybe it's like a dark tunnel, or it's like a wall. You're right up against a wall. You don't know how to go forward. And I was there in 2003. And I spent time seeking the Lord, praying, calling out to the Lord, and asking, Lord, what do you want us to do? Where are we going? I'm not seeing the promises that the Lord gave me in the beginning. And I'm not experiencing the victory. And in that time of seeking the Lord, there was a breakthrough. And the breakthrough came because I surrendered to the Lord. Say surrender. I surrendered my desires. I surrendered everything I had. I surrendered back to the Lord again. And I said, Lord, you know, I didn't save myself. You saved me. I didn't seek you. You sought me. You know, I was in the world. I was living for the world. I didn't care about God. I didn't care about anything of the kingdom. And the Lord came into my life. My life was a mess. You know, that's just true. And the Lord came into my life. He found me. And I know he also found you. Can you say amen? Amen. And he's changed my life upside down. And so with the same with the congregation. And in that time, the Lord spoke to me and he gave me a vision. That's normally how he speaks to me. I know he speaks differently to other people, but he speaks to me through visions and dreams. And he made a promise in the book of Joel. He said, in the last days I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And he said, your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. So God speaks through visions and dreams. That's something that we need to take note of. That's something that we need to, the language, we need to get to understand God's language. And the way he speaks to us individually. He speaks to us individually so that we can understand him. And he spoke to me. And basically showed me that there are three seasons that we are going through. It's three phases from 2003. And if I look back now, it seems to me that each phase lasts about 10 years. It's about 10 years, then we get into the new season, the new phase. And when I saw the vision, and it was all about the kingdom of God. Now, I don't want to tell everything because it's quite a long thing to tell. But let me just tell you this. In this vision, my wife and I, we were walking next to a river. And then there were two rocks, and we got up on the one rock. I got onto the one rock, and she got onto the other rock, right next to each other. But these were not huge rocks. These were small rocks, about a meter high, I would say. And she was standing on this one rock, and I was standing on this other rock. But in front of us, there was a huge rock, a huge rock. Huge rock. It was round, round, round. And I knew that we had to get onto that rock. I knew that is where we ought to be. But I couldn't see any way of getting onto that rock. And as I was standing there thinking to myself, how are we going to get onto this rock? Now let me just say to you, when I have a vision or a dream of my wife, it normally speaks of a congregation. I would say 9 out of 10 times, it speaks of the congregation. And the path, the way of the congregation, what God wants to do with the congregation. And the next moment I saw like a Jacob, you know, there's this ladder just coming down, and the ladder was put against this big rock. And my wife was like, she was first on this ladder, and she started climbing on to this ladder. She climbed up and I followed her. At that point of time, I was wounded in my one leg, terribly wounded. It was, I can tell you the previous story, but I won't tell you about that. I know where the wound came from. I was wounded, and I was going up slowly onto this on this ladder. And she was on the rock, just quickly. She was on the rock. And she went like this, you know, she looked. And she could see far. And it was like she was looking over a valley. And she was like, you know, taking a deep breath. She said, wow. And I said, what do you see? And she said, and she just called out. She said, the goodness of the Lord. Do you remember that? The goodness of the Lord, she said. The victory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord. She said those three things. And the Lord gave me the meaning of that. That we would go through three seasons, three phases. And then we'll get to the glory of God. Now I can tell you where we are now. We are getting towards the end of the second season, which is the victory of the Lord. We are in the worst battle, the fiercest battle we've ever been. Not only our congregation, but the entire church. But I want to say to you, we are going to gain the victory. And it's going to be a complete victory. And we are going to be lifted high on the rock, the kingdom of God. And who knows that the rock is Jesus Christ, the King of Kings. Can you say amen here this morning? So I want to encourage you this morning. Don't backslide now. Don't fall away, because we are right there where many Christians are backsliding. They're falling away, and they are going to be left behind, and they're going to miss the best that is yet to come, and that is the glory of God. See, the church of Acts lived in the glory of God. They lived every day. They lived in such a dangerous time. It was a small church, but it was a church that was birthed by Holy Spirit and the power of God and the presence of God and the fire of God was in that church, and his supernatural ability was with them every day. They were so in the glory of God that they had no fear of the world. They had no fear of persecution. They were even ready to give up their lives to die for the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? Why? Because they lived in the glory of God. There's a big difference between the anointing and the glory. The anointing is God's ability upon a person. When I preach this morning, I'm preaching under an anointing. God has enabled me with an anointing. Same with you. Every child of God has got an anointing. And that anointing enables you to fulfill your purpose. That anointing is a measure of Christ. It's a measure of the Spirit of Christ that is in you. But that measure of the Spirit of Christ that is in you empowers you. It sets you alight. It gives you the power and the strength to overcome the evil one. Can you say amen here? You guys, you mustn't be too quiet. You can be loud. All right, I like it. You say, yeah, amen. Praise the Lord. Some Angus. The thing is with the anointing is limited. It's not God that is limited, but we limit the anointing because we are only one person. And that's why Jesus said to his disciples, I'm leaving you. I'm leaving you, but he who believes in me, he shall do greater things than what I'm doing. He said, but don't be heartbroken, because if I don't leave you, Holy Spirit won't come. But when he comes, you will receive power. Dynamis. Power is dynamis. From where we get the word dynamite. You will receive dynamic power. And he was speaking to the whole church. Now, when we come together like this morning, we have different anointings. Say to somebody next to you, you have got a different anointing than what I have. We are all vessels with oil. Have you got oil? Have you got oil? You have got oil. If you're in the house, you've got oil. Inside, you should have oil. There's oil inside. If you didn't have oil, you wouldn't be here today. I can promise you that, because it's that oil that's inside. If there's no oil, there's no fire. There's no will. There's no desire. Can you say amen? It's the oil inside of you and the fire that comes upon the oil, because oil without the fire cannot burn. But where there's oil, the fire of Holy Spirit burns inside of you. There's a supernatural desire, a supernatural zeal inside of you. That fire cannot be quenched. That fire can never go out, because it's Holy Spirit fire. But we need the oil. And when we are together like this, we carry oil. That's more powerful than just one person ministering under the anointing. Because how many people are here this morning? I don't know. But if I have to go to each one this morning, and I carry the anointing, and I go to start with this brother here this morning, and I'm going to bless him, I'm going to minister to him from my anointing. And that's not wrong. We are the body of Christ, and my anointing can help him in his situation. Maybe I can give him a prophetic word, or maybe he needs healing. And somebody that carries the anointing of healing will come and minister to him, and he will receive healing. Because whatever was in Jesus is now in us. Can you say amen? Whatever was in Jesus when he walked here 2,000 years ago on the planet is now in the church. The Spirit of God, that same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, is living inside of us. We are now the temples of the Holy Spirit. Our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. Are you with me? Now, when I have to go now this morning and I go with my anointing, what is going to happen? I'm limited. The anointing is limited. And even if we all stand together, we all have a corporate anointing, there's so much power in it. There's so much power. And when we all release our anointing, things will happen. We get breakthrough. That's what we do and what we've done. And what you guys did when I was in hospital. And when Valhalla was in ICU, that's what we did. And Louis, yeah, I was in the hospital last night with COVID. We all came together and we prayed. And we prayed. We broke through. Because the anointing destroys the yoke of the enemy. That's the power of this church. And I'm not speaking from from arrogance. I submit myself to the Lord. I give glory to God. Can you say amen? Because the anointing is not I. The anointing is not you. The anointing is Jesus living inside of us. It's the Holy Spirit inside of us. To him comes the glory, belongs the glory. Amen. So there's power in the corporate anointing. But there's more. And that's where we are going. That is where we are going. You say, where are we going? I believe things have turned already. I believe things are busy turning. In the spirit realm, things are turning. I believe the victory is there already. And next year, we're going to gain momentum in the victory of the Lord. But there's going to be a moment that we are going to step into the glory of God in its fullness. We can now get into the glory and we'll get taste of the glory, foretaste of the glory. What is the glory? The glory is different from the anointing. The glory is God sovereignly showing up. It's God coming into our presence sovereignly. It is not the anointing. It is much more. It is the presence, the holy presence of God. It's the holy presence of the angels invading a building, invading a city, invading a nation. And the church of Acts lived in that glory. It was like holy. It was like they were just sort of, you know, filled up with the glory of God. It was so powerful upon them that even the shadow of the disciples, if that fell upon sick people, they got healed. Even if aprons touched people, they got healed. That was the glory of God that was so upon them that people could experience the glory. People could experience the presence of God. And you know what? Man has got nothing to do with that. It's God's presence upon us. But there's one secret. Say to somebody, there's one secret. To step into the glory, we have to get into the secret place. We have to get into the secret place. And that's what the message is all about this morning. Get into the secret place. After the word, we're going to have communion. Lord is preparing our hearts. Let's read here. In the book of 2 Corinthians 3 verse 15 to 18 we read, yes, even today, speaking of the Jews, when they read Moses' writings, that's the law, their hearts are covered with that veil and they do not understand. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. See, there is a veil. There was a veil in the tabernacle of Moses. There was a veil. In the temple, there was a veil. So there is a veil. And the veil speaks of separation. The veil speaks of no entrance. Nobody is allowed to go in. There was a separation. But the word says here, but whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. What is the secret place? I'm going to mention a few things. In the Tabernacle of Moses, it's called the Holy of Holies. In the temple, it's called the, or in heaven, it's called the throne room. It's also called the presence and the glory of God. It's where God is. It's that place in the Spirit where we encounter Holy Spirit. It's where, like Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 6, when King Uzziah died, in that year, Isaiah came into the Spirit and he saw the Lord sitting on his throne. And he saw the train of his robe that filled the temple, his temple. And he saw these magnificent, majestic angels called seraphim. And each one of them had six wings. With two wings, they covered their feet. With another two wings, they covered their faces. And with the other two wings, they were flying. They were in the throne room and they were ministering to God. The place was filled with the glory of God. These seraphim angels were very powerful angels, but they are the throne room angels ministering the glory of God. And Isaiah saw this in his vision. And here in Isaiah chapter 6 verse 3 we read, they were calling out to each other, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of heaven's armies. The whole earth is filled with His glory. Praise God. Amen. It's also that place called there. When God spoke to Moses, here in the book of Exodus 25, verse 22, the Lord spoke to him and he said to him, I will meet you there. Now, where was that? And talk to you from above the atonement cover between the goat cherubim that hover over the Ark of the Covenant. From there, I will give you my commands for the people of Israel. You see, the secret place is that place called there. That place where you meet God. That place where you encounter Holy Spirit. That place where the Lord reveals some things to you. That place where He empowers you. That place where He sends you from. He speaks to you from there, from that place, that secret place. It is also what King David experienced, but he called it the secret place. I like it, especially now for our time. The secret place is very appropriate. Because we read in Psalms 27 verse 5, for in the day of trouble, He will hide me in His shelter, in the secret place of His tent. He will hide me. He will lift me up on a rock. Can you say amen? You see, it's this time that we are in now. And King David had this experience when he came into the secret place, and we know that he was a worshiper. He loved God. He loved to worship God. He was a musician. And he sang songs to God. One time, the Ark of the Covenant, the tabernacle was broken down. So what did David do? He went and he got the Ark from the house of, I think it was Obed. And he brought it back to Jerusalem. And he pitched a tent. He put the Ark inside of a tent. And he put musicians to sing in front of the Ark. Day and night, they worship God. David knew something about our time, because this is where we are now in this end time, because we can come into the presence of God. Can you say amen? Because the veil was taken away. And then he said, this is what David experienced. When we get into the secret place, we are hidden. God hides us from the enemy. He cannot find us. He doesn't know where we are. And in that secret place, God lifts us up high upon the rock. He restores us. He energizes us by His power and His presence. I want to be there. Can you say amen? That's where we need to go. That's where we need to come. That is where Holy Spirit is taking us. He's taking us to that place. Now, how to come into the secret place? Let's go quickly. Now, I'm asking a question. If the Lord removed the veil, what is holding us back? What is holding me back to enter into the secret place? If the Lord took the veil away, because that is what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches the veil is taken away. If we've got born again, we gave our lives to Jesus, got born again, the veil is taken away. So as far as God is concerned, there is no more veil. He took the veil away. What is holding us back? I thought about this. Many years, many times, I thought about this. Because in this house, we've come through many seasons. And especially in our worship, there were times I can remember, because I was there. Many of you were not. At one time we had a very, very gifted, anointed musician. I mean, he was a whole band. He had two keyboards. And he had worshippers. He had the drums, he had the guitars, he had whatever. He programmed everything into those two keyboards. And apart from that, he carried an anointing, because that's basically all he did. And he would lead us and would come to that place in the spirit. Like, I tell you, it's like just there. You know, I'm here. I'm here now. It's just like at the door, at the entrance of the glory of God. The presence of God was light, not heavy. Do you know that the glory of God is heavy? Heavy. That's why the ark was made of gold. Because when the presence of God comes in, it's heavy, heavy. It's like a weight that pushes you down on your knees. It's holy. Even the children, the babies, senses it. It's just like it becomes quiet. God's presence is so tangible. There's a fear, holy fear, not a terrible fear, a holy fear. Who knows what I'm talking about? And I'm speaking about very rare happenings that I've experienced through the years. But there is the fullness is going to come. That's what the Church of Acts had. And we're going to that now, into that season. So there's something that's holding us back. Now the Bible says here in the book of Colossians 2 verse 14. Now listen to this, because this is a key scripture. I'm giving you keys now to enter into the secret place. Because you can enter in your secret place in your closet, in your prayer room. You can enter into the secret place by yourself. But also here in the corporate worship. And this is what God wants. He wants His church corporately to enter into the secret place, into the throne room, into there, that place where we meet Him, there, where He meets us. This scripture is very important that you need to write in your heart. You need to store it in your heart. You know, we store many things, but this is a... It's very good to store the Word of God inside of us. See, He canceled Jesus when He hung on the cross. He canceled the record of the charges against us. Think about that. When Jesus hung on the cross for us, He canceled the record. The Afrikaans Bible says the skuld brief. Because we must remember the devil is the accuser, eh? He wants to keep us away from God. So he accuses us. He cancelled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. Come on. Jesus cancel the record against me. Whatever sin you have ever committed from a young age, Jesus canceled. There's no record in heaven of your sin. If you are in Christ, there's no record of sin, of your sin in heaven. No record as far as God is concerned. Because Jesus canceled the record of all the charges against you. What did He do with that record? He nailed it to the cross. Praise God. He was nailed. It was just as well. You and I was nailed to the cross. You already hang on the cross in Jesus. If you've got your faith in Him, you've paid the price. You've taken the judgment. You've taken the curse. You were condemned. You were abandoned on the cross. Because Jesus identified with us in a human body. So what is He doing? He's saying to you and I, come now, believe in my sacrifice, and this record is nailed to the cross. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a praise offering. See, our own veils, we've got our own veils. This is what's keeping us out. Not God's veil. God, when Jesus died, and He called out, just before He died, He said, it is finished. What happened in the temple where the veil was? The veil was torn from the top down. It was God that turned, that tore the veil. It wasn't the hands of men. It was God who said, Jesus paid it in full. All who believe in Him is welcome now to step into my presence. Wow. Our own veils, it's our lower nature, the flesh, condemnation. The Bible says that the Jews have still got a veil on their hearts. Why? Because of the law. The law brings condemnation. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. So wherever there's a law, judgmentalism is, condemnation is. That brings a veil. This is what happened to the Jews, and they've got this veil because of the law. They're under condemnation. Never accept a spirit of condemnation. It's not from the Holy Spirit. Can you say amen? Amen? The Holy Spirit will convict us, but He will not condemn us. Because Jesus was already condemned. If somebody or something wants to put you under condemnation, no, it's not from the Lord. Condemnation, unbelief, these things, these are our veils, offenses. We take offenses in our Adam nature, in our lower nature. And it makes us hesitant to go into the presence of God. It brings a hesitancy in us. It robs us of our boldness. Come on now, here. You know how we should get into the presence of God? We should get into the presence of God with joy. We should run into His presence. And we say, Abba, Father, I love You. I want to sit on your lap. Come and sit on His lap. You know, I've got my little grandson, Berit. When I come in the mornings, he waits for me. He's here with his mother. What is he? 3 years. He's 3 years old. But he can't wait for me. When I step in there, you know, he plays hide and seek with me. But he makes sure I see him. So I walk into that blue room and I go and sit down. And the next moment, he runs in there, jumps on my lap. You know what I do? I give him a sweet. And I hug him. And I kiss him. You know? There's no fear. There's no condemnation. I mean, did you brush his teeth? Maybe he did. But you know, there's no hesitancy. There's just this boldness. This is how we get into the secret place. We run into the secret place because of the blood of Jesus, not because of us, because Jesus took the veil away. Jesus took care of it. Can you say amen? Amen. Let me finish now. I'm going to tell you pastor testimony. This really blessed my heart. And let me just give a word of warning. On YouTube and social media, there are a lot of near-death experiences. I don't know if you've noticed that. Not all of them are from the Lord. We always have to judge it according to the Word of God. Anything outside of the Word of God, we can reject. Because there could, and there are false near-death experiences. But this pastor, and just because he's a good pastor, I believe he's the near-death experience. He's very authentic. What happened to him? He's quite an elderly man. And he became sick in his lungs. Terrible, terrible lung disease. Not this virus. Something else. An incurable lung disease. And he had never smoked in his life. The doctor said, sorry, we can't do anything for you. So he deteriorated. And eventually he was on oxygen. And his name was on a list for receiving a transplant, but nothing happened, nothing came. And he was about at the end of his life, and him and his wife, they were driving down some road in the car. His wife was driving, he was weak. And they started singing. His wife started singing a song, praising the Lord, you know, lifting up her hands and driving and lifting, singing. And what happened? All of a sudden, she just said, Lord, I surrender everything to You. We're not going to fear the future. We're not going to fear death. We're not going to fear, because at that time, he had to resign from the ministry. He was so sick, he couldn't handle the ministry anymore. He was just getting ready to die. The finances went right down. They had barely any income. He started doing some things at home, like artwork and so on, try to make a living. They were at the lowest point ever in their lives. There was no hope. And in this car. Now let me say to you something. God has got the habit to show up suddenly. Have you heard that before? Have I said that to you before? The one moment there's nothing. There's nobody. The very next moment, He says, I'm here now. And when he's there, everything changes in an instant like that. God begins to change everything. So wherever you are now, don't lose hope. He has not forgotten about you. And what happened? As she was surrendering, all of a sudden, there was a deer in the road. And the deer was standing right in front of them. And she slammed on the brakes, not to hit this deer. And as they stopped, the deer's gone. So what was that? Did you see that? Yeah. I saw the deer. What happened to it? We didn't hit it. It just vanished. And they were puzzled. And then this pastor, he went to the scripture. He started thinking about the scripture. David's singing, as a deer panteth after water, so my soul panteth after you. You know? And he's one of his boys, his sons, his name. He's a dancer, and his name is linked to dancing. The people call him a dancing deer or something, like jumping deer or something. That is like his, you know, his nickname. I thought, well, I'll go to him and ask him. Maybe the Lord's told him something. He was searching, trying to find out what. What is God saying to us? Because they realized this must have been from the Lord. Some answer from the Lord. And then he started praying about it. He went into the Word. And eventually came to the tribe of Naphtali. And he found out that Naphtali's, that name means deer. And it actually means, I've seen you in your trouble. And isn't that a wonderful way God speaks to people? Through a deer. I've seen you in your trouble. And at that moment, he just realized, I'm not going to die. I'm sure God's going to give me a new pair of lungs. And sure enough, not long after that, the hospital phoned and said, you must get here quickly. We've got a pair of lungs for you. Somebody has donated. Somebody, you know, somebody died and they took the lungs. The lady donated her lungs. And he was in line. And they rushed him to hospital. And he went into a 12-hour operation. And they did a complete lung transplant upon him. But during the operation, somewhere through, something went wrong. There was some doctor made a mistake, whatever. And I don't know, his blood pressure dropped or whatever. But he died for a short while. And they started fighting to get him back, because he was now in huge trouble. But in that moment, when he died, his spirit left his body. He saw himself going out. And he's got quite a good sense of humor. And he said, you know, at least I was going up. He was thinking to himself, at least I'm going up. That's a good thing. For a pastor, I'm going up. Because if you're going down, it's not a good thing. So I'm going up. And the next thing he saw, like, there was like rainbow lights swirling around him. And he thought, what is that? And he saw all these rainbow lights. And then he heard singing. And there was angels singing, started singing. John is coming home. I think it's John. John is coming home. John is coming home. And then a voice said, no, he's not coming home. He's only coming for a visit. And he was taken up into the throne room. He was taken up into that secret place. He was taken up into the presence of God. And the next moment he found himself in that room. And there was this light. As far as he could see, it was just light. It was just light. And he knew the Lord was there with him. And all of a sudden, now here's the thing. That veil, those veils I'm talking about, that Adam nature, that lower nature, all of a sudden, he started thinking of all the things, the wrong things he did. And before he could think too much about it, the voice of Jesus came to him and said, I took care of it. And just like that, he was set free. I took care of it all. He was set free that moment. And Jesus, and then he had this desire to thank the person who gave her lungs to him. He had this desire. And Jesus put his hand up. Jesus was standing behind. He put his hand upon him. And the person was next to Jesus. And he turned around. And he thanked the lady. I thank you for giving your lungs for me. And the Lord, what he said, they didn't speak to each other. It was just like thoughts coming to him. Saying to him, accept the lungs. You need to accept. And this is the thing. We need to accept the power of the blood. We need to accept and believe in the power of the blood. Can you say amen here this morning? We need to believe that the blood is powerful enough to take it all away. The power of the blood has dealt with my sin. And whatever, all my veils, God's veil is torn open. I can go into His presence. It's me who puts up the veils. My sinful nature. At that moment, all his worries, all his anxieties, all these things just flew away. And he was sent back, came back into the hospital, into his body, and he was in a coma for some time. Eventually, he came out of his coma and he's on his way to recovery. What is, maybe you've got veils. I want you to stand now with me. Stand with me. Maybe there are veils, things holding you back. I want to say to you this morning, we're going to have communion. I'm going to ask the leaders to come forward. Before I read this last scripture. But when you have communion this morning, I want you to go and stand before the cross. See yourself before the cross. And take your veils and surrender it to Jesus. Maybe you feel you're not worthy. You feel unworthy. You feel dirty. You feel guilty. You feel ashamed. Maybe you feel offended. I want to ask you. Put it on Jesus. Nail it. He already nailed it to the cross. You just have to let go of it. You have to accept like that guy, pastor, accepted the lungs. You have to agree with Jesus. Afterwards, the pastor said he had this revelation that he had to agree with Jesus for that thing to be a success. Agree with Jesus this morning when you have communion. Agree and say, Jesus, I surrender everything that's holding me back. All my veils, all my... My English is nou so moeilik. Die goed wat my terughou. My hang-ups, wie weet waarvan ek praat. Ek gaan op die stoel staan as julle nog so vir my kyk. Ek mag op die stoel staan, want ek is die pastoor hier so vanmorgen. Listen. Al jou hang-ups. Al jou tekortkominge. Al jou kromheid. Al jou skeefheid. Wie is nie krom en wie is nie skeef nie? Moet nie hand opsteek nie. Jesus weet. Ons is allemaal krom en skeef. We are all, by sin, we've all been messed up. By our low nature, we've all been messed up. Can you say amen? Amen? I want you this morning, get out of pride and say, Jesus, I believe in your blood. I submit to the power of your blood. I release all these veils because these are all my own veils. And take them, nail them to the cross because your presence is open for me. I'm going to go in with boldness. Can you say amen? Amen. Right. Before we have communion, I'm going to read you this story here. Hebrews 10 verse 19. It's not a story, it's a scripture. And now, we as brothers and sisters in God's family, because of the blood of Jesus, and He welcomes us to come into the most holy sanctuary in the heavenly realm, boldly and without hesitation, for He has dedicated a new life-giving way for us to approach God. For just as the veil was torn in two, Jesus' body was torn open to give us free and fresh access to Him. And since we now have a magnificent high priest to welcome us into God's house, we come closer to God and approach Him with an open heart, fully convinced that nothing will keep us at a distance from Him. For our hearts have been sprinkled with blood to remove impurity, and we have been freed from an accusing conscience. Now we are clean, unstained, and presentable to God inside out. Isn't that wonderful, powerful? That is the power of the blood. Amen. So where are our leaders? Pastors, leaders, come please. And let us get the community out to people. And I want to ask the band to come forward. Okay. We're going to try to finish not later than 11. Because let's have our communion. Let's take the blood this morning. Surrender. And then we're going to go in worship with a clear conscience, knowing if your hands were dirty this morning, you know what I would do? I would give you soap. And you know what you would do? You'll take the soap and you'll wash your hands, and your hands would be clean. I want you this morning to take the blood of Jesus. If there's anything that's holding you back, take the blood of Jesus. Say, Lord, I apply the blood because I put my faith in the blood. It's not me. It is the blood of Jesus that gives me that entrance into His presence. Will you do that this morning? Amen. Amen. So, have we got leaders here? No leaders. Where are they? Come here, please. Okay. We're going to thank the Lord. All right, will you give it out to the God's people, please? Receive it, and they're going to lead us. And we're going to flow out of the communion. We're going to flow into worship. Because we come into His presence through the blood. Right, and I want you to focus on Him this morning. Have an encounter with Him. When you go home, you're going to feel in your heart, wow, I met the Lord this morning. He was there for me. Amen. Right, come forward, please, and come and have communion. Then you're going to say a prayer by yourself. Spend time with the Lord by yourself. Surrender. That is the key word.